Could the financial catastrophe of 2008 have been prevented by a more vigilant Securities and Exchange Commission? More importantly, perhaps, could the next catastrophe be prevented by one? In our fourth story in the countdown, what we do know now is that in the years leading up to that meltdown, the top cops on Wall Street routinely destroyed information on promising cases. That in an investigation published in the New Rolling Stone by Matt Taibbi, who will join us momentarily. His piece also details a revolving door of friendly executives who move from leadership of the SEC to top jobs in firms they had recently regulated. The Inspector General of the SEC is supposed to issue his own report on the coziness. A Senate committee is looking into it. Matt beat them to it. Federal and state prosecutors have yet to put a single senior Wall Street executive behind bars for any of the many well-documented crimes related to the financial crisis. Top federal regulators spend more time lunching, schmoozing, and job interviewing with Wall Street crooks than they do catching them. Need any historical evidence of that? Who repeatedly graded the investment house of Bernie Madoff, Snow White? The SEC. As promised, here's Countdown contributor Matt Taibbi of Rolling Stone. Good to see you, sir.
Good to see you, Keith.
What is the evidence that the SEC has been destroying evidence?
Well, the SEC has several levels of investigations. Basically, any preliminary inquiry is what they call a MUI, a matter under inquiry. And a MUI is just any investigation that's before the level of a formal inquiry.
Right.
And what they've been doing, dating back to 1993, is they've been destroying the records of any MUI that has not proceeded to a full investigation. So all these preliminary investigations of Bernie Madoff, AIG, Goldman Sachs, Citigroup, Lehman Brothers, as many as 18,000 cases, the evidence for all of them has been destroyed.
So if somebody had had a brilliant realization about what Madoff was doing in 2004, and there had been an investigation in 1999 with somebody else who'd moved on, who'd had the same idea, there'd be no, for the guy in 2004, there'd be no record from 1999,
no
and for the guy in 2008, there'd be no record of either of them.
Exactly. There was no way to cross-reference them. That's exactly what happened. Somebody would call in with a tip, or they'd get a tip from FINRA or from the New York Stock Exchange about suspicious trades. You get a team of SEC guys, would look into it for a few weeks, maybe a couple of months. They'd do some interviews. They'd ask for permission to proceed. It might get rejected by a future employee of Bernie Madoff or Citigroup. And then they would shred the documents afterwards.
Is there an indication that there's anything specific like that? I mean, are they killing productive investigations, or are they at least, in theory, clearing out stuff that wasn't going anywhere?
No, we know absolutely that at least a couple of them were Bernie Madoff related. So, and another thing that the whistleblower came forward with this case, he also came forward with some examples from his own career as an investigator, in which a very, very promising investigation involving securities fraud with Deutsche Bank was suppressed by an enforcement director who a few days later took a job as the general counsel of Deutsche Bank. So we know that this is part of the culture at the SEC. They have most of the people who are running the agency are high-priced political appointees who work for the same banks, or sorry, who used to work for the same banks they're supposed to be regulating. And so many of these cases get rejected, and it's by these bureaucrats who are looking to go back to Wall Street and take these multi-million dollar jobs.
All right. Now, we asked the SEC for a comment on your story, and they said we don't comment on stories, but there is an unconfirmed retort that one of the inspectors or one of the investigators supposedly fired for pushing back too hard on an investigation was actually fired not because he did that, but because he was reaching some sort of crescendo in his employment where in another couple of weeks he would have gained tenure and could never have been fired, and he's just the classic disgruntled former employee. Are you satisfied that this isn't just an extraordinarily large number of disgruntled former employees?
Right. No, that's they said that this current whistleblower, his attorney is a former SEC whistleblower named Gary Aguirre, who was fired for trying to investigate the CEO of Morgan Stanley, John Mack, in an insider trading case. He was fired by people who went to work for Morgan Stanley's law firm a year later. They called him a disgruntled employee, even though he himself had gotten a pay raise just before he got fired. The same thing with this current whistleblower. He has nothing but an exemplary record. He's had pay raises and accommodations. So for them to paint him as a disgruntled employee is ridiculous. That's just simply not the case.
I don't like to. I know sometimes it sounds like I make President Bush sound like the Goldstein of everything.
Right.
I don't want to pin all this on him, because obviously, as you suggest, this has been going on since 1993. But did something systemic change change in the SEC when he put former Congressman Chris Cox in charge of it?
Yeah, absolutely. In 2000, the SEC started going toward a model where they would allow companies to investigate themselves during this MUI stage. What they would do is they'd get a complaint, and then they'd go back to the company and they'd say, could you hire a lawyer and look into yourself and then file a report back to us so we can decide whether or not to investigate you? Now, apparently this system worked okay for a couple of years, but when they put Cox in, my sources tell me that this process just became a joke and these investigations just routinely went nowhere.
Wait, did they find that in the college sports system where you're supposed to investigate yourself?
Exactly.
And, we're killing ourselves, we're turning ourselves in.
Exactly.
Is that where they found this? Because it makes about, just about as much sense.
I mean, one of my sources said to me, just imagine if the LAPD would ask the Crips and the Bloods to look into whether or not they were guilty of drive-by shootings. That's exactly what was going on in this system. And they're still doing it.
Now, they're also the Inspector General of the SEC is working on his own report on all this. Mm-hmm. Do we have any hope for that? Because it sounds like it's the same thing as asking the companies to investigate themselves.
Well, the SEC Inspector General David Kotz actually is a pretty aggressive Inspector General, and I actually do think that something might come out of it. I mean, the record of Inspectors General in the past decade or so hasn't been great, but apparently this one is a pretty good one. So people do have hope for this.
So he's not going to wind up working alongside the guy from Bank of America who greeted Rick Perry today?
Right. He'll be in Rick Perry's administration.
Jeez. Matt Taibbi of Rolling Stone, Countdown contributor. Great thanks as always, and have a great weekend.
Thank you, Keith.
Thank you, sir. 5 million pieces of bulletproof body armor for American troops that can't stop bullets. Congresswoman Louise Slaughter and the fight to give our service personnel the minimum chance. Coming up.